Hi everyone, welcome to our low carbon video cast series. Today we're joined with Matt Cotton, who's an industry leading expert in the field of net zero carbon and in particular operational carbon. I'm Hulusi Mustafa, Environmental and Sustainability Manager. Matt, welcome to the podcast.
Great, thanks Lucy, great to be here. Just to introduce myself, Matt Cotton, I'm a director at a company called Twin and Earth. We're a energy and sustainability consultant. We do a lot of work on energy and sustainability performance of domestic and non-domestic buildings. Just a little bit about myself. I'm a chartered engineer. I've been doing sustainable kind of low energy buildings for over 17 years now. So, great to be here and great to be talking about net zero carbon, which is kind of a key focus of our clients.
Obviously, there's been a huge emphasis around climate change, in particular in the past few years. You've got climate change figures such as Greta Thunberg and Sir David Attenborough spearheading the climate agenda. Obviously, we had COP26 last year, which reinforced the targets of no greater than a 1.5 degrees increase in temperatures above pre-industrial levels. And obviously, we've got the UK agenda, which is to reduce carbon by 78% by 2035 above 1990 levels, and also the target for net zero carbon by 2050. So before we get a little bit technical, Matt, if you don't mind giving us a definition on what you see as net zero carbon.
Yeah, sure. Net zero carbon, I think there's been a lot of kind of confusion kind of over the past few years about the definition. In terms of kind of coming up with the definition, actually it was the UK GBC kind of actually back in, I think it was 2019, started to kind of come up with a definition. That's really evolved, and there's been a number of professional bodies that have got involved. The Whole Life Kind of Carbon Network being one, there's the London Energy Transformation Initiative being another. We've seen obviously kind of, you know, we've got the kind of REBA and others kind of. I think kind of in terms of kind of definition, there's kind of starting to become a kind of consensus in definition. And actually, I think there's a really good document actually produced by the Whole Life Carbon Network and Leti last year with support from REBA, which set out kind of a series of definitions. So in terms of the I think the commonly agreed definition, it kind of has to kind of cover a number of principles. So a building has to not use any kind of form of fossil fuel, so gas or oil. It has to make sure that all energy is minimised in the building as well. And that's through what you call kind of passive design principles, or looking at your heating, kind of ventilation, kind of cooling systems, how to reduce that. There's another kind of key requirement as well, kind of that the definition introduces, which is this idea of having local energy use targets, or EUI. We'll touch on that kind of as we get into things. But and then kind of there's another kind of then additional requirement for any energy that's produced or kind of consumed by the building, it's going to come from on-site or off-site renewable energy sources. I think kind of one key kind of principle, though, that we all need to kind of get used to is that when we talk about net zero carbon, it kind of needs to relate to the in-use performance. So it's all well and good us kind of coming up with designs that kind of on paper kind of work, but actually the proof's in the pudding. So ultimately, it's kind of about how the buildings perform in use.
Sure. So what we're not talking about here is the design aspiration for energy use intensity. We're talking about the actual energy performance of the building.
We are talking about the design. So obviously, kind of during the design stage, there needs to be kind of ways of kind of predicting the energy use. But ultimately, kind of as I say, kind of the proof's going to be in how the building actually performs in reality.
Okay. And just back to the topic around definition. So we've got various types of carbon that people would have heard of, including, you know, embodied carbon, operational carbon, and whole life carbon. Would you mind just summarising where does operational carbon sit within that picture, please?
Yeah, sure. I mean, there are a number of terms that we're all getting used to as an industry, aren't there? So you mentioned embodied carbon obviously deals with the construction emissions. So we're not covering that today. I understand there's another podcast that kind of covers that. So operational kind of carbon, we're mainly talking here about kind of what you call regulated and unregulated energy use and kind of the carbon associated with that. So the unregulated kind of energy is kind of basically to do with kind of the tenants' energy use. So that's IT equipment, kind of in a perhaps an office environment or server rooms. the regulated energy are things like heating, cooling, ventilation, lighting, and all those types of things. I think fundamentally, kind of as an industry, though, what we need to appreciate is that you mentioned about these targets, net zero carbon by 2050, 78% mm-hmm. reduction above 1990 levels by 2035. Ultimately, kind of that's as the UK as a whole, kind of across all sectors. So as the built environment sector, we need to kind of realise that we've got our apportioned bit. So we need to kind of be kind of driving down our own emissions kind of within the built environment.
Sure. And again, just back to another definition, please, Matt, if you would. So a term I've heard thrown around quite a lot recently is the term carbon neutral. Hmm. And so would you mind clarifying what's the difference between being net zero carbon and carbon neutral, and can they be used interchangeably?
Yeah, absolutely. And this is partly why the kind of the we've actually, it's worthwhile mentioning that point, that there's a kind of a new initiative, just before I kind of come on to kind of carbon neutrality, a new initiative actually that the has kind of come about the past few months, actually called the UK Net Zero Carbon Building Standard. And actually it was kind of they're actually kind of looking for people to kind of input into that standard. So I understand we'll kind of include a link actually to that kind of to the website. So if you're interested actually in getting involved and actually helping define kind of those standards, that's basically kind of cross-party kind of initiative to try and bring together all these different kind of professional bodies to make sure there's consensus over kind of all these definitions.
Sure.
We're going back to your point around carbon neutrality. Carbon neutrality is kind of where a building can basically kind of burn and kind of as much kind of carbon as it wants. So there's no requirement for kind of no fossil fuels or kind of meeting these energy use intensity targets. But ultimately, to kind of define yourself as net zero carbon, all you need to do is offset. So effectively, you're kind of paying someone else to basically do your dirty work in a way to kind of obviously kind of offset the emissions that you're that your building is emitting. So obviously that's not kind of a great situation to have. So hence we've got the focus on net zero kind of carbon.
So playing devil's advocate here, Matt, why don't we all just go around saying we're carbon neutral, emitting as much as we want, and then just offsetting?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. I think kind of the main issue is that there's only so much renewable energy that we can kind of produce. Whilst offsetting kind of, you know, can play its part, again, it's just moving the problem elsewhere. And there's only kind of so many trees we can plant or kind of, you know, kind of projects we can
sure.
kind of fund. So that's why we need to focus on kind of reducing our energy demand. So that's where this energy use intensity target kind of comes in, but also kind of bringing this requirement for using on or offsite renewable energy. There's an excellent kind of graph actually that was is in one of the UK Green Building Council framework documents, which actually is quite a simple kind of graph, but it shows that by 2050 we need to see a big reduction in the energy demand of buildings, and then we need to see a big increase in the kind of the renewable generation, so both on-site and off-site, as mentioned. And then we kind of get to this sweet spot where they both meet. So, you know, all the energy that we're kind
sure.
of demanding is being generated by renewables.
Interesting. And we'll include a link to that graph. So with all these definitions and these terms, net zero carbon, offsetting, etc., does this only apply to new builds?
Definitely not. So, I think there's a... we often hear consultants or the industry kind of talking about kind of net zero carbon applying to new builds, but I think we just need to remember, I think there's a kind of stat that's often kind of bandied about, which is that in 2050, 80% or approximately 80% of the buildings that exist now will still be operating in 2050.
Wow, yeah, it's a pretty sobering statistic actually. And when I heard that, I thought, well, we really need to be looking at retrofitting what we already have.
No, absolutely. As an industry, we need to be focusing. I mean, new build, obviously, kind of, you know, we can do a lot, and there's a lot of opportunities with new builds to really change and affect the way that those buildings operate. But we really, as an industry, need to be focusing on existing buildings
sure.
as well. You know, light retrofit, deep retrofit, mm-hmm. you know, depending on the kind of nature of the building.
Sure. So just in terms of understanding the energy performance, energy efficiency of buildings, a term, you know, a lot of our clients and listeners will be familiar with is the term EPC, mm. Energy Performance Certificate. And I'd be keen to see where you see EPCs fitting in this net zero carbon picture.
Yeah, again, great question. So, I mean, EPCs definitely play their part. So obviously an EPC rating is a kind of, it's a, for non-domestic buildings is a kind of a, an indication of its kind of its carbon performance. And it's kind of quite a good, you know, kind of quite a good metric and way of kind of driving up energy efficiency. Obviously, kind of, you know, kind of a higher rating, a A or B rating, is obviously going to be better than a than a kind of a low rating. The problem is that kind of it's the EPC methodology is kind of quite simplistic.
Okay.
So whilst it'll tell you kind of in principle kind of what the building can achieve in terms of its carbon performance, it won't actually tell you what its in-use performance would be. And actually, kind of there's an excellent kind of piece of work that was done by the Better Buildings Partnership back in back in 2012, actually, kind of, and again, I think we can include a link to that particular kind of document. Mm-hmm. But basically, it showed the comparison between the EPC rating of buildings and the actual energy kind of performance of a, basically a kind of a set of office buildings. And what the kind of the research showed was that there was no kind of no link, basically, or very kind of little link between the EPC rating and its actual in-use performance. So you could have a kind of a an A-rated EPC building, which actually kind of performed kind of worse in use than maybe a, an E-rated building. So, and what that kind of has brought around is about this kind of concept of kind of performance gap. That actually kind of, you know, we can, it's all well and good designing a fantastic building on paper, but actually how does it kind of like constructed, kind of commissioned and actually kind of delivered, and then ultimately kind of managed and used by kind of the you know, the occupants and the users of the building. Ultimately, again, the proof's in the pudding, the proof's in the in-use performance.
So Matt, interesting you mentioned about EPCs and this performance gap that, that you've seen. Mm. So a lot of our clients, tenants, landlords, etc., will be familiar with MEES, Minimum Energy Efficiency Standards. Mm-hmm. Would you mind telling us a little bit how the EPCs relate and the current regulations that have come in place with regards to that?
Yeah, sure. So kind of... kind of a few years back now, kind of obviously you had the introduction of the EPC regulations, and then a few years back we then had a kind of a minimum standards for kind of buildings that were going to be let, and that kind of introduced a requirement for a minimum E rating. So basically you couldn't let an F or G rated building. So and you may be aware kind of there's going to be kind of the government have been consulting kind of on upgrading those regulations again. So they're introducing kind of a minimum requirement for a B rating in 2027, sure. And then a C rating in 2027, and then a B rating in 2030. So say that will really help to kind of drive the energy efficiency of buildings up, but it still doesn't kind of help us in terms of understanding our energy use intensity, kind of going back to that point.
Sure. And just on that, a term that I've heard mentioned recently is this idea of stranded assets. Mm. Do you mind kind of just speaking a little bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, kind of a stranded asset can apply to kind of both, it could be an EPC rated building or it could be its energy use kind of as well. But basically it means that kind of the building is behind the kind of curve in terms of where it should be. So from an EPC perspective, it could be kind of one that is, you know, not a B rating in 2027. So in effect, it becomes kind of unlettable. But also kind of thinking about energy use intensity, we're seeing kind of clients now kind of starting to kind of look at more depth in terms of the kind of the carbon emissions of a building and also its energy use intensity, and looking kind of like in the future to kind of where it should be in order to kind of to meet the definition of net zero kind of carbon. And if it's, again, if it's behind the kind of the curve, then potentially it could be an issue in terms of being able to sell the building or let the building.
So Matt, most people listening will be hearing all these terms and thinking, great, I really want to now deliver a net zero carbon building. How do they go about doing that?
Yeah, so obviously kind of, we've introduced this kind of this definition of net zero carbon, which I think the industry is kind of starting to kind of consolidate now. But I think it'd be worthwhile maybe just talking through that in a bit more detail.
That would be helpful, yeah.
So, yeah, I talked about the first kind of stage, which is about removing any form of fossil fuel use. I think particularly kind of that's an issue where kind of a lot of buildings kind of up till now have been using kind of gas-fired systems, so gas-fired boilers, gas-fired CHP, for particularly for space heating, hot water, but also for things like catering as well. So we can't just think about kind of how the building is heated in terms of its space, but also kind of, you know, additional functions within the building.
Sure.
It's about kind of maybe looking at alternatives to kind of to those types of systems.
Okay, and just on that point, so a lot of our clients, especially within obviously fit out, are moving into buildings which have existing gas fired heating systems. In that instance, what do you recommend being done?
I mean, the kind of the most obvious solution at the moment is to introduce electrically powered heat pumps. So those heat pumps can be operated from, you know, kind of water source, ground source, or most commonly kind of air source heat pumps. So so that we're seeing, kind of in the industry, we're seeing a big shift to that type of technology. There are other technologies that will no doubt kind of come forward. So the use of hydrogen technology, for example, in the future, still in its relative infancy, and we're not sure exactly what place it'll have, kind of, but certainly in terms of a kind of like an immediate kind of thing to do, replacing gas boilers with heat pumps is the way to go. There are technical kind of issues around that which need to be resolved, and in terms of the way that heat pumps operated, but certainly that's certainly the best approach. So just a kind of a small anecdote really, but we're working with a kind of a client. We've very recently been working with a client who has just taken a long-term kind of lease on a building, and they were sold kind of a building which was, you know, kind of EPC, kind of, you know, high EPC rated, and it had an excellent BREEAM rating, and it was kind of world standard, kind of this and that. The problem is that actually kind of the building that they've kind of leased, which actually isn't that old, has a gas-fired heating system in it. So, and actually kind of, it seems like an obvious thing to point out, but when we kind of raised it with the kind of client, obviously in terms of meeting that net zero carbon definition, that's going to be a problem. So we're starting to do some work with them to work with the landlord to look at their long-term plans in terms of how do they remove those systems.
Yeah, interesting. So you're talking about collaboration between tenant and landlord here.
Absolutely. And, and as an industry, again, there needs to be a lot more kind of collaboration to make sure we're meeting these requirements.
Indeed.
So we've talked about fossil fuel or minimising or eradicating fossil fuel use. The next kind of step, as mentioned, is about the energy use intensity targets. So in order to meet those targets, there needs to be kind of a real focus on kind of on energy efficiency. So in terms of the energy use intensity targets, it's kind of quite a new kind of concept for us as an industry again.
Absolutely.
And I suppose kind of, again, if you kind of look at the comparison to kind of like other industries, if you take kind of the vehicle industry, for example, you know, for years we've kind of been using your miles per gallon, and it's that's kind of a term that most people kind of understand. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting, as an industry, we don't really understand energy use intensity. We don't know kind of talk in terms of kind of levels. We don't kind of really maybe understand kind of what's good and what's bad. So, and that's kind of really a terminology, energy use intensity, that we need to start kind of getting a lot more used to.
Agreed. And it's interesting you say that. I think there is a whole upskilling in the industry just around general terminology and transparency about what things actually mean in terms of energy performance. And so just focusing on that point around EUI, so energy use intensity,
yeah.
Are there separate targets for landlord and tenants with regards to those?
There are. It's an evolving area. And I think kind of, again, the industry's working together to kind of to derive different targets. The UKGBC actually kind of, as part of their original framework in 2019 and subsequent work, have kind of set out kind of landlord and tenant targets and whole building targets. But it's an evolving area. So kind of, and again, I think we'll kind of start to kind of see more targets coming out for different building types as the industry starts to kind of work on developing these kind of these metrics. So we've talked about kind of eradicating fossil fuels, energy use intensity targets. Next step is very much around kind of, you know, looking at where the energy comes from. So I mentioned on that definition, so about having on-site and off-site renewables. And the primary focus should be kind of looking at kind of on-site renewables. So that's things like PV, you know, particularly in an urban environment. Can you put kind of photovoltaics on your roof? That's your best form of kind of local on-site renewables, so trying to maximise that. Where you can't kind of meet all your energy demands through on-site renewables, which kind of is the case for most buildings, particularly in urban areas, you should be looking at off-site renewables. And that's through kind of basically procuring energy from energy suppliers, but where the energy suppliers are producing renewable energy. And that brings in this term kind of additionality. So the energy that is supplied from offsite renewables needs to be in addition to any renewables that are kind of currently generated at the moment. So we need to be looking at kind of how we kind of fund kind of like more kind of renewable generation.
Okay. And so, Matt, just to contextualize that. So we have a situation, if you have a landlord, they have, say, solar PV, they're generating their energy on site from a renewable. The alternative to that, which is the kind of the next step, I believe, down in that hierarchy, is then to produce to purchase energy from offsite renewable sources. And the key there is about additionality. So that's where the renewable infrastructure is generated from the purchase of that that renewable energy that otherwise wouldn't have existed effectively.
That's right. It's kind of creating kind of more capacity, renewable kind of capacity. So in order to meet kind of the offsite kind of additionality requirements, something called power purchase agreements that could be used, which is basically where there's a kind of contract between the kind of the people that are kind of consuming the energy and the supplier of the energy, to say kind of actually kind of there's a contract to say kind of actually kind of can you generate more kind of renewable kind of capacity, kind of invest in that kind of renewable kind of capacity.
Okay.
And it directly links then back to the kind of demand of the consumer.
Sure. And I suppose that would then give energy suppliers a level of certainty, I suppose, on the fact that there's going to be a demand for the renewable energy that's being supplied.
Absolutely. It kind of creates that certainty. It kind of, so suppliers can go out, they can kind of build that additional capacity.
Interesting. So if I want to go into a power purchase agreement, PPA, would we literally just call up a mainstream energy supplier and say, can I have a power purchase agreement?
Yeah, it is kind of contractually, it's kind of quite complex. So you might need to take advice, but certainly kind of having an initial discussion with a kind of a supplier, they can kind of perhaps kind of talk about options. So again, I know we kind of keep recapping, but I think it's important to kind of understand the kind of the net zero carbon definition, those requirements that were previously mentioned. So no fossil fuel use, the energy use intensity targets, the on and off site kind of renewables. So the kind of the last step is offsetting. So I know we talked about that in terms of kind of carbon neutrality. It still does have a small kind of part to play in terms of net zero carbon. Sibsey and Letty have actually kind of released some kind of guidance recently, and they've recognised this kind of concept of kind of upstream emissions. So if you think about it, even if you kind of generate kind of renewable energy, there are kind of, from a wind farm or a kind of PV farm, there are going to be transmission kind of losses, distribution losses. So they need to be kind of the carbon emissions associated with that. So it's kind of called upstream emissions, and those emissions need to be kind of covered. And under the kind of the current consensus of definitions, basically there's an allowance to kind of use kind of carbon offsets to kind of cover those upstream emissions.
Okay.
In terms of kind of the types of kind of carbon offsets, and again, this is an evolving area, but the UK GBC kind of have released some very nice documentation which talks about kind of the types of kind of offsetting schemes that are of high enough kind of quality. And so, things like kind of the UK Woodland Code and the UK Peatland kind of Code are two kind of types of kind of offsetting kind of schemes that you could kind of fund to offset those upstream emissions.
They're useful links, and we will include links to those, Matt. Okay. So that's great. So we understand the concept of offsetting and purchasing from green tariffs. But I think what everyone's probably thinking here is, how do we then go about that key process, which is reducing the primary energy demand associated with our buildings? And maybe you could just give us a quick summary of what you think would need to take place.
Yeah, sure. So we haven't really spoken about actually how you kind of meet the energy use intensity targets, for example. So kind of, and it comes back to kind of really, I suppose, slightly more basic stuff, really. So I think a lot of us know about the energy hierarchy. So kind of fabric first, you may have heard, or kind of, the kind of passive first. So, and that's all about kind of reducing the demand for energy in the first place. So, and that's through things like, looking at your new building or your existing building, look at things like, can you kind of look at kind of glazing ratios, the fabric performance, the U values of your building, introducing kind of external shading kind of within the building, looking at introducing natural ventilation. So not having sealed buildings, having operable windows, looking at mixed mode ventilation. So there's a number of things that should be looked at. And I think certainly kind of owners of buildings, developers should be kind of exploring all those passive principles first. The next thing to look at is then kind of the efficiency of the types of heating, ventilation, air conditioning services and lighting within buildings. So, and that's really about kind of, for example, you know, introducing obviously high frequency LED lighting, kind of intelligent lighting controls, occupancy daylight controls, looking at kind of things like low fan power systems. We're seeing a big kind of move from centralized air handling units more to kind of maybe floor by floor localized.
Interesting.
Air handling units, because that reduces the duct length and it reduces then the fan power of those types of systems. So, but also basic stuff like kind of, you know, minimum insulation standards and what have you. A lot of that's actually driven by building regs. So the building regs actually sets kind of standards as well. So that's kind of a good place to start. But obviously kind of going above and beyond those standards is a good place to aim.
There's some really useful tips there, Matt, just looking at how practically we can look at driving down building energy demand. Mm. But I'd be interested to hear from you the challenges that are typically faced with doing these initiatives, in particular the challenges faced separately from a landlord versus a tenant. So if you wouldn't mind going into that a bit more.
Yeah, sure. I mean, obviously from a landlord's perspective, it's kind of it's all about, if you've got an existing building, what type of systems have you got within the building, and also how does the fabric perform? So going back to those kind of, you know, that hierarchy, fabric first, kind of passive design. So the challenges for a landlord are going to be, well, what, how does my existing building perform and what can I do? And obviously there's a cost associated with that. There are technical limitations, issues around kind of heritage buildings, kind of listed buildings, etc. So, but a lot of those issues aren't unsurmountable. It just needs kind of to be thought through. And that's where this idea of having kind of a kind of clear plan of kind of, you know, retrofit kind of plan. Maybe that you don't kind of, you know, the landlord doesn't do the work kind of now, but they may decide kind of, you know, 5 years' time, they've got all these interventions that they want to apply. From a landlord's perspective, also there's kind of can be issues around kind of oversizing of plant as well. So particularly when heating and cooling plant is kind of specified, as an industry we tend to kind of design for worst case in terms of particularly kind of cooling loads in commercial buildings. That can be a kind of problem when you're kind of introducing heat pumps into a building, because a heat pump will only operate efficiently if the kind of the heat pump is sized based on the actual occupants, the actual loads within the building.
So that's really interesting, Matt. So we focus there on kind of base build landlord, but in terms of the issues faced and challenges faced as a tenant, yeah. You know, and obviously we're talking here generally about things we can do within the commercial sector, but from a fit out perspective, a tenant perspective, what are the challenges and initiatives that you see being put in place?
Yeah, so I mean, obviously the tenant normally has less control over the total energy. So, and we've talked about the landlord on the landlord side. Sorry, one thing I didn't mention on the landlord side is obviously they've got usually control over the kind of what you call the central plant.
Sure.
So, you know, the main heat source and kind of chillers. We talked about oversizing, but fundamentally is that question about if it's gas fired. Yeah, how can they transition to kind of a renewable source of, or a low carbon source of energy? So we talked about heat pumps as an example. But going back to the tenant, the tenants kind of have got control over, you know, lighting, obviously. Kind of, so if you're doing a fit out, you know, if you've got a kind of a cat A design, looking at kind of what the efficiency of that lighting system is. If you're introducing new kind of lighting, kind of you know, obviously specifying you know, very efficient lighting, introducing lighting controls if they're not already in place, but also thinking about the IT equipment within a tenant's control as well. So there could be things like kind of adopting kind of procurement policy around kind of Energy Star rated equipment, for example, or having kind of adopting kind of power management kind of across kind of IT, you know, within a kind of commercial sense. There are other things that could be done around things like maybe internal temperatures and set points within buildings. So maybe relaxing them. So, you know, in the summer, people kind of come slightly kind of more dressed down. Maybe kind of they don't need the kind of the building to be controlled to such a tight temperature. There's one thing we've been advising kind of clients on and discussing with a number of kind of clients recently is around, obviously, with the advent of hybrid working, you might find that certain days of the week, actually, you've got less people within the office. And actually kind of other opportunities to maybe close off certain parts of the office so you're not ventilating, heating,
really
kind of cooling them. I mean, again, it sounds like a basic thing to do, but actually it's a kind of the types of things that we need to start exploring if we're really going to start hitting these energy use targets.
Absolutely, a whole shift in industry thinking and occupier thinking.
In terms of energy metering, often kind of there's a chap called Peter Drucker, who's an Austrian-American management consultant. He kind of came up with this kind of term, you can't manage what you can't measure. And so whilst we talked about kind of obviously upgrading buildings in terms of fabric systems and what have you, we also need to kind of be able to measure the energy. So we talked early on about kind of the net zero carbon definition, and ultimately it's the in-use performance that we're interested in. So unless we've got the right kind of meters within a building, there's no way we can really understand how the building is performing. So it's really important that kind of we put kind of proper sub-metering in. The likes of kind of BREEAM and kind of the SIBSE TM39 do kind of really kind of drive good levels of sub-metering, but it's something that really needs to be kind of introduced both to existing and new builds as well.
Yeah, and I suppose a similar challenge will be faced there between a coordination between a landlord and a tenant to make sure that you've got sufficient splitting of sufficient sub-metering to allow for that identification of where energy is being consumed and by what.
That's absolutely right. And again, you may have heard of the Neighbours UK.
I have, Matt. Yeah,
rating scheme. So that kind of that scheme actually has introduced a whole kind of new kind of metering kind of set of metering requirements, and actually kind of there's a real push there to make sure that there is separate sub metering between kind of tenant and landlord.
So Matt, give you a scenario: we've got a brand new base build, heat pumps installed, sub metering galore, super efficient fabric. Tenants come in, we've got a design that is super efficient, we've got high efficiency lighting, glare control. Where can it all fall to pieces?
Yeah, I mean, the last bit before the operator takes over the building is making sure that you've got proper handover of the building. So you can have the most wonderful building, but ultimately, if the occupants of the building, the user of the building, the FM team don't know how to use the building, then, you know, they're basically just chop the keys and then kind of left to kind of get on with it. That's where it could fall over. And that's where the kind of concepts of things like soft landings kind of comes in. So, you know, to really make sure your in-use performance is actually you're delivering, you need to make sure that FM teams are involved from the during the design stage. They have a say in terms of how the systems are set up, maybe sharing experiences about how buildings that they've perhaps operated in the past haven't worked kind of correctly.
Sure.
So you can make sure that you're, you know, not repeating the same errors.
Sure, sure. So what you're talking about there is the human aspect of the building, which can create, in effect, I suppose, this performance gap, which you mentioned earlier.
That's right. And I think kind of, you know, it also kind of comes down to things like, you know, really good commissioning, fine tuning of the building. So don't just leave kind of, the landlord team, the FM team, just to kind of go alone. Make sure you kind of keep giving about do seasonal kind of commissioning.
Absolutely, and something I've seen brought into to tenants quite a lot within their management protocols is this idea of kind of power management. You know, turning off monitors, etc. Maybe you've got some experience with that.
Yeah, actually, kind of anecdotally, actually, kind of during lockdown, I kind of did I was lucky enough to kind of go and actually leave home and do a survey of a building in the city, kind of a large office building. And actually, what amazed me was the amount of monitors that had kind of screensavers whizzing around or pictures of their kind of people's last holiday and what have you. There was no one in the office, you know, so kind of, the amount of energy that was being consumed just by that alone. So, you know, there are basic things in terms of kind of power management that should be adopted. Absolutely.
Yeah, those finer details. Yeah, yeah. And so if we have a client and they're really keen to achieve net zero carbon, they've done everything that they can within their power, you know, reducing energy demand, on-site renewables as much as possible. But there's something there stopping them achieving net zero carbon status as such. What do you recommend?
Yeah, so there's this kind of, again, it's an evolving area, the SIBSE and Letty kind of in the latest guidance introduces kind of concept of net zero in progress. So I think kind of there's a realization that it's going to take time to kind of, particularly with existing buildings, to improve them. So it's a journey. You know, obviously it needs to be a fairly rapid journey, but nonetheless, for a lot of buildings, it is a journey. So there's a kind of this net zero carbon in progress introduces two requirements. One is Has the kind of the, you know, if you are doing works to the building, have you explored all the opportunities kind of, you know, that align with the net zero carbon definition in terms of no fossil fuel use, trying to meet the energy use intensity targets, et cetera? So that's the first requirement. And there may be kind of limitations on why you kind of can't meet kind of, you know, for example, we talk about gas boilers. There may be a reason why you kind of can't just instantly swap out a gas boiler with a heat pump. So that needs to be kind of, but pushed as hard as we can. The second requirement for net zero carbon in progress is then to have a really concrete plan to how you are going to then kind of align with the definition. So, you know, we talked about kind of landlords, for example, thinking about kind of, you know, stripping out the gas boilers, putting in kind of low carbon sort of forms of heating, or thinking about kind of upgrading the fabric performance. So between those two things, as long as those two things are kind of really well defined and kind of pushed, then this concept of net zero carbon in progress can be used. It's not a formal definition kind of yet, but
so people can't go around now and say we're net zero carbon in progress.
And I think that's where the kind of this new kind of UK net zero carbon building standard is going to kind of come into play, kind of about really kind of getting kind of industry kind of consensus around those definitions and making sure that kind of we're not greenwashing, we're not having people saying one thing and actually meaning another thing. So,
sure.
So yeah, there's still a bit of kind of work to do, but I think kind of that net zero carbon in progress will certainly play its part in terms of long-term decarbonisation.
So Matt, you've spoken quite a lot around the concept of energy use intensity and ensuring that is defined in a project and that there's a strategy to achieve that energy use intensity. But how do clients go around modelling or designing to an energy use intensity target and knowing whether it's achievable or not?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great point because, again, we've stressed the fact that kind of ultimately the proof's in the pudding, the proof's in the in-use performance. But, you know, design teams kind of obviously kind of, you know, kind of need to be able to kind of advise kind of clients on whether they think kind of these energy intensity targets will be achieved. And that can be achieved by kind of doing what we call advanced modelling, kind of advanced energy modelling. There are a couple of kind of approaches for non-domestic buildings. The one is the Neighbours UK design for performance approach, which is kind of goes into a lot more kind of depth in terms of how you kind of model the energy performance of a building at the design stage. And then the other one is TM54, SIBSE TM54, which is a has been around for a few years now, but that sets out a methodology for predicting the kind of the in-use performance. So both of those kind of modelling techniques should certainly be integrated kind of early on in projects to make sure that kind of you get a kind of a deep understanding about your in-use performance or your predicted in-use performance.
Sure. And so you do all this modelling and the building needs to deliver X energy use intensity for the landlord and the tenant. How does a base build ensure that once a tenant comes in, they're delivering on those targets that have been set out in terms of energy use intensity?
Well, again, that's about kind of collaboration. So kind of it's about kind of the, I mean, ultimately we're talking about kind of the whole building kind of energy use as well. So we talked about the kind of the landlord's got their kind of their responsibilities and kind of the things that they can affect, and the tenant's got the things they can affect. But ultimately what we need to see is kind of landlords and tenants kind of coming together, working collaboratively to understand, the landlord can understand how the tenant's going to use the building. The kind of the tenant can then kind of maybe kind of work with the landlord to understand kind of what their future plans are in terms of decarbonisation. So it needs to be kind of a real kind of, you know, really kind of collaborative approach to building design and operation.
That's great, Matt. Today you've spoken about some really interesting topics, gone through a whole myriad of definitions and the process to achieve net zero carbon. We've also gone through energy use intensity targets, which seems to be a key driver and how we get there and the challenges that you've faced. And we've also talked around relevant standards to help deliver that. But just before we wrap things up, I'll ask you a question. If there was one thing you could change in the industry, what would it be?
It's quite simple, actually, and I suppose this applies not just to net zero carbon. It's about having a very clear brief from the outset. So we often get involved with kind of projects, and the design team kind of just jump into kind of, you know, solutions. But actually, what we need to be doing is really kind of setting out a very kind of clear set of principles, whether it be the, you know, net zero carbon, you know, the no fossil fuel use, or the energy use intensity targets, having kind of, you know, on-site renewables. setting those requirements very early on, so everyone's very kind of clear on what the expectations are, and that needs to be really driven by the kind of the client. So I think if the kind of client gets behind it, the project team will get behind it as well.
I'd absolutely agree on that one, Matt. Thank you for your time today. I have, and I'm sure audience have come away with some real tangible kind of advice and things that we can do to excel our net zero carbon objectives. Thank you, everyone, for listening. I believe this will be available on social media in various snippets, and will be on YouTube, as various podcasts as well, wherever you get your podcasts from. A full list of the references made today, UKGBC, Leti, SIBSE, etc., will also be listed there, so feel free to take a look at those. And thank you for listening.